and say, yes, my sister, you were in drugs, but I'm here to pray for you. I'm here to help you through that. Yes, my brother, you may have been a part of a drug, but that's not a family. This here, this kingdom is a family. Come with us. That is why I say discernment of the spirit, judgment. Amen. You must not judge. Leave that to the Lord.
Amen.
And so a quick analogy, a quick story, a quick example to base it off of is baseball. How many of you watch baseball? Mm-hmm. Like watch the Toronto, Blue Jays play. They're a good team. And baseball, my family, we watch baseball. And as you watch baseball, you see how everything works. You see how you have to run to first, second, and third, and then back to home to get a point. And the one thing that I noticed about God is God is a God of order.
That's right.
Everything he does in order. Everything happens for a reason. Yeah. It is in order. It is laid out in steps. Everything in the Bible, when it's given to us, is in steps. God's not just going to tell you, hey, do this. He says, do this. So you can do this, so you can receive this. Yes. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. That's a step. And all of his righteousness, second step. And all things shall be added. That is a result of following the steps. The Bible is a blueprint for us to follow. And so when you play baseball, when they play baseball, here comes in the process of judgment and discernment. When you play baseball, you're up at home base and you're getting ready to swing. And because you didn't read the ball right. You didn't discern the ball right. You didn't read it quite right. And it was a curveball instead of a fastball. So you go to swing, and you only bump the ball a little bit, and it rolls just a little bit down the field. That creates chaos. Why that creates chaos is because now you have to run as fast as you can to first base before they pick up the ball and throw it. And let me tell you, they throw pretty fast in baseball. You have to, so you get everyone out. And so as you're running to first base, you not only have to focus on first base, you have to focus on the man who's going to get the ball to make sure that you have the proper timing so that you're there in time before the ball gets there. That creates chaos on the field because now that the ball is running, you have an outfielder running in, you have an infielder running out. Who's going to get the ball first so that who's going to get it so that person can be out? All kind of confusion and chaos. That's not what we want. When you go out and reach, so you don't want confusion and chaos. You don't want to judge someone and be like, oh, they're this way. Oh, and then you go over here and they're like, why am I like this? Why can't the church accept me for the mistakes that I've made? Yes, I made mistakes. And then that's when hypocrisy comes in. And we don't want that kind of stuff because we don't want others to think that we're more holier than they are. We have sinned just as they have sinned. And we're there to help them through their sin the way that we have been helped through our sin. We're saved by grace. We want to pass on the love to them. And so that is not a home run. That creates chaos in the field. Now, when you get a home run, you're standing up at home base. And you're ready to hit the ball. And see, this time you read the ball right. You discern the ball right. You discern the spirit right. So you realize that it's not a curveball this time. It's a fastball. And so as you're winding up to hit, you hit the ball, and it's a home run. There's no running involved. You don't need to run to first base to realize it's a home ball. The people in the outfield are not running to find the ball. They already see that it's a home run. So there's no chaos going on. Everybody already knows what's going to happen. Everybody already sees that it's a home run. There's no need for chaos. There's no need to wonder who's going to catch the ball now. There's no need to wonder how fast am I going to get there. Because as soon as you hit that ball, they already know it's a home run. They already start to play that siren. They already know the stands. Everyone's standing up and clapping. They see it. They feel it. And that is what it means to discern the spirit. When you go to someone, you discern their spirit and you catch a connection, that's a home run. There's no need for chaos. There's no need for misunderstanding, because when you know what God has placed in you, you know that you have peace within your spirit. You know that you have joy within your soul. You know that you have love to pass on to other people. That's why you have to understand that judgment and discernment are two different things. Many say it's the same, but there are two different things. Judgment is left for the Lord. God tells us to pray for the discernment of the spirit. Pray that he will give you the ability to read people's spirit, and never underestimate the Lord, because he will equip us. He will equip us with the right tools and instruments to use. He equipped David against Goliath. He equipped Moses against Pharaoh. He equipped Job against the enemy. He will equip us when we go out, because out there's wickedness roaming. The enemy is seeking whom he may devour. And as soon as you step out the covering of God, as soon as you step out the little walls of your church, the enemy is going to be on you like crazy. And that's why you must know who God is. That's why you must know what he has placed in you. Because you see, Job Job didn't know that God has chosen him as his lovely servant, the enemy would have ripped him apart. Because see, the story of Job had everything. He had a home, he had a wife, he had kids, he had land, he had animals. And the enemy said to God, let me test your faithful servant.
Yes.
And God said, yeah, go ahead. Go test him. It's fine. That's my lovely servant. Go ahead and test him. And so the enemy came and wiped out everything.
Yes. Yes.
Took away his kids, his family, his land, his animals, his house, everything. The only thing he had left was his wife. And even then, his wife said, why don't you just curse God and die? Like, why even doing this? Why even bothering with this? And Job said, no, my God will see me through. My God will see me to the end. And God will always see you to the end. See, the race is not given to the swift, nor the fastest. It's given to the one who can endure to the end. And God wants us to endure to the end. So he equips us with the tools and the instruments so that we can endure to the end. So Job continued to pray. And he said, yes, Lord, I lost everything, but I thank you because I'm still here. Lord, even though I lost my children and my wife and my car and my house and my animals, I still praise your name because you're glorious forever and ever. I just want to give you thanks for who you are. I want to praise you for who you are. And because he was so steadfast and because he knew who God was and what God placed in him, God blessed in him more than he could have ever asked. More animals, more land. God blessed him more on top. And see, the thing is, when you know what God has placed in you, you can go out and win souls. Not only they will get blessed, but you will get blessed. Because God's blessing will pour from heaven. When a soul is saved, the angels in heaven sing out hallelujah. And when you sing out hallelujah, the blessing from God starts to pour out onto your life. You will see the blessing come. No bucket can hold it. No room can hold it. No place can hold it. You just gotta give it. And that's why it is important to know who you are. Know what God has placed in your life. Go out and win souls. Don't be afraid. Even though people in church may tell you you're not made up for that. Even though some people will say it's not real. Even though people will tell you you're not ready to go out and win souls. When God says you're ready, you are ready to go out and win souls. When God says, my child, you are ready, go and fight. When everyone thought David wasn't ready because he was too young and he was too skinny and he wasn't ready, he wasn't equipped, that God told him, you are ready. Even though they may not give you all of this stuff, I've given you life and life more abundantly. I've given you the full armor of God. I've given you my love. I've given you my joy. I've given you my strength, oh God. I've given you everything. Go and fight for me, my brethren. Go and fight for me, my son. And so that is why it is important to know what God has placed in your life. Because when you do, you have that power. Just like Lucifer had that power. He knew. And he had such power. He knew what God placed. When you know what God placed in your life, no enemy can come to you. The enemy may come and tell you things. And you say, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The Lord is my strength and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Almighty God, you just gotta lay down your life for the Lord and let him take you up and lead you. Let him guide you where you need to go. Let him direct your path where he wants to. Let the will of God form in your life. And every single person I spoke about, they let the Lord lead them. They let God pour into their spirit. Don't be afraid to let God pour into your spirit. Don't be afraid because you're so used to this. You're so used to the quiet preaching, or you're so used to this kind of in the box. Come out and step out. That's what God wants. God wants someone who can step out for him. God wants someone who can stand up for him. God wants someone who can stand up and say, my God is God, and nothing can stop my God. God wants someone who can be bold and stand, I believe in Jesus Christ. You can take my life, but I'll still believe in Jesus Christ. You can take my joy, but I'll still believe in Jesus Christ. You can take my love, but I'll still believe in Jesus Christ. You can take my peace, but I'll still believe in Jesus Christ. You can take everything, but I still believe in Jesus Christ. You must know what God has placed in your life. You must know what God is doing in your life. your life. That way when you go out there and you're ready to save souls and you're ready to win souls, you have the power. The love is just radiating off of you everywhere you go. God, and everyone talks to you. Oh, you're a Christian? Oh, God bless you, my brother. You're a Christian? God bless you. Oh, you go to church? God bless you, my brother. Oh, you seek the Lord? God bless you, my sister. I love you. That love will radiate off of you and everyone will just want to be around you. Everyone will sense that spirit. Wherever you go, that spirit is following you. And that's what you want. You want God to work in your life. Because the Bible cuts sharper than any two-edged sword. And that is sharp. Just cut every kind of enemy out of your life. Just cut down every wickedness. Cut down every stronghold. Cut down every disease and distraught of the enemy. You have to know what God has placed in your life. Prepare for a change to come. Prepare for God's people to come. Prepare for the kingdom, us right here, to stand up against the enemy, to stand up bold and say, you can't take my people, you can't take God's people. We are going to march right out of Egypt right now. We're going to march out of Egypt onto the promised land. Oh, stand up and give God a praise. Stand up and worship his name. Stand up and give God a praise. Because no weapon formed against you prosper. Nothing that the enemy has for you can come against you. Almighty God, God will equip you with the tools and the instruments to destroy the enemy. When all seems lost, when you're at the back of the line and everyone is laughing at you, just tell them, you wait. When God turns my life around, I will be now at the front in the name of Jesus. I will be the head and not the tail. For my God is mighty, mightier than anything else, Almighty God. His presence is there. Just lift up your hands and worship. Lift up your hands and give him praise. He is new every morning. His grace and his mercy abound with you, my brothers and sisters. God be praised in the name of Jesus. I thank you for a time. I thank you for listening. I thank you for your wonderful time. In Jesus' name. Amen.
That is exegeted.
Yes.
The text.
Thank you.
It was a long text.
Yes.
But you know what? It's one of the hardest types of preaching, exploratory preaching, they call it. Taking the text and interpreting it right exactly the way it should be.
Yes.
And so it tells you the ability and the kind of preparation that she went through.
Yes.
And that is why I said, she's like me, in many ways, because I was a runaway freight train and I just started preaching. I just wanted to preach and preach and preach and preach. But it is all determination. And if you have listened to her, you can see what I'm talking about. There's a baby that is crying through her right now. And it is for us to mentor and work with her. How many believe that with me? I don't have to tell you. You heard. Is there improvements? Yes. I've preached how many years, and I think there's, I learn all the time. And so it is our desire to work with her. Father, in the name of Jesus, I'm asking you one more time that you would just fill her with the anointing. Fill her with your anointing. Open doors like you've never done it before. God, I'm asking you, Araya, sure, Holy Spirit, teach her.
Yes.
Teach her. Teach her. You be her teacher. And God, that you will allow us to work with you as you work with her. And so right now I'm asking that you will bless her one more time. Anoint her one more time. Fill her one more time. In Jesus' name. Let's give her a hand.